And here we are once again for the next talk. Just as a side note, if you recognize some kind of humming noise, that is, we have a guest here in the studio. It's a little fly that is going around in circles around the microphone up here. So don't be irritated by that. It's a special guest. Consider it like that. Now, next speaker. You had a look at the schedule, right? Božidar Batsov. You all know Božidar. If you are an Emacs person, you are most likely using some of his code in some of his libraries. And if you are a Clojure and Emacs person, which today is very likely, there's 100% chance that you're using his code. Most important of all, it's the CIDR project. So I had a look at the CIDR project, and it makes up 24,000 lines of code, roughly. And it has grown to a significant size. I think it's fair to say that. And now, 24,000 lines of code, as all of you know, is quite a lot of complexity. And this is exactly the topic of the talk today, the complexity in CIDR. So, I just learned that you can press Z in GatherTown to dance. So let's try that instead of the wiggle. Go for it, Božidar Batsov.
Hey there, everybody. My name is Božidar. I hope you have some idea who I am, because I don't really want to go over everything in this slide. If you need to look up something about me, you know how to do this. I am very happy to be here with you today, because 2020 was very hard for everybody over the world, and 2021 so far wasn't much better, unfortunately, even though there is finally some light at the end of the tunnel. There have been no Clojure conferences for me since February last year. The last Clojure conference I attended in person was in Clojure in India, right before all of this craziness started. And this is something that makes me very, very sad. On the other hand, if there is something that I managed to learn from the Monty Python movies, this is that no matter how bad things are looking, you always have to be looking on the bright side of life. And this is what I have been trying to do recently. I wasn't able to travel outside of Bulgaria, so I decided to do a little bit of local tourism and explore the homeland. I finally found the time to get married, which was rather nice. And if you ask my wife, it was also way overdue. I finally got the opportunity to build that custom desktop PC that I was planning to build for at least 5 years and switch from macOS to Linux. But unfortunately, this didn't work out very well for me, as it turned out that the video card that I bought wasn't working very well on Linux. So I ended up being a Windows user accidentally. And this leads me to this big revelation that the presentation that you are currently watching was created in PowerPoint. I'm not a PowerPoint guru by any means, not that I was very good with Keynote, but there is a funny story about my first and only Clojure D presentation 4 years ago. For various reasons, it was done in PowerPoint, and I ran into some technical difficulties which converted my talk in a complete fiasco. Hopefully this time around I'm going to do better. So, more revelations. Turned out that Windows is pretty awesome, highly recommended. You should try it. I totally love it. Other than program, on Windows you can also do some other cool things, like play StarCraft 2, something that I was planning to do for at least 10 years, and I totally loved, and Diablo 3, which I wasn't really planning to do, and I kind of regret doing, because Diablo 3 was just as bad as I expected it to be. But anyways, we are on a Clojure conference here, and we have to talk something about Clojure, right? I know that the topic is about complexity, But if I'm giving a talk, people expect me to say something about cider. So how has cider been doing in those trying times? Well, it got some releases, most of them small last year, one for enclosure, one later together, and one bigger, 026, with the support of the closures together, which made the initial experience, the out-of-the-box experience, much nicer if you're not using cider and REPL. This was mostly related to some changes that had been happening in parallel in NREPL, of which I'm really proud. In particular, there is now code completion and lookup functionality built in the REPL server, which is very, very cool. There is also the ability to inject middleware straight from the clients. And this opens up all sorts of avenues, but you know, very simply put, this means better user experience for all of you and less setup hassle. I think this is a win-win, right? Afterwards, after this initial flurry of development, I kind of got a bit depressed, and I picked up my open source work only at the end of the year, or the grand release of Cider 1.0, which was more or less the same as the previous release. And very recently, I've been working on Cider 1.1, which was released just a month ago, and which fixed many of the issues that managed to sneak into Cider 1.0. Overall, very little has happened compared to previous releases, but as you see in the presentation today, less is more, and less changes are not necessarily a bad thing. I actually think that they're a pretty good thing. But let's go to the beginning. Victims of complexity. No dictionary definitions today, but I do have a rather challenging task ahead of me, because a lot has been said in the Clojure community on the subject of complexity. We obviously have the amazing talk by Rich himself, Simple Made Easy. And of course, many Clojurists have read the legendary, at this point, Out of the Tar Pit paper. So, What can I possibly add here? Well, let me try. For me, the subject of complexity in software engineering always was represented perfectly by one tweet by Joe Armstrong, the creator of Furlang, from around 3 years ago. The Groundhog Day development method invented a new simple thing. Add features. Add more features. Add more and more and more features. It's so complicated, nobody can use it. Throw everything away, go to the beginning. Is there a way out? And this is what we are going to discuss today, because in my professional experience, every project that I've ever worked on unfolded more or less like this. And many of the open source projects that I have been working on unfolded rather similarly for one reason or another. So let's try to understand complexity without dictionary definitions. We are going to be doing this, or attempt to do it rather, with a simple case study in complexity, inspired from your favorite Cider project. Namely, this is the connection management functionality in Cider. You don't really need to be a Cider user or to be particularly familiar with it to understand the concept of connection management in Cider. Basically, Cider is a REPL client for the NREPL server. It connects to the server and send some code to be evaluated there. That's all you need to know. Early versions of cider were really simple. There was the possibility to have only a single connection at a time. This was the ultimate simplicity, as that there was no configuration related to connection management, no ambiguity. You always know that you have a single connection and this is the active connection. Of course, this also meant that there was a certain lack of flexibility. This was the only connection you had, and if you wanted to work on multiple projects, you had to disconnect, create a new connection, which was kind of painful. And also, after Clojure Script became popular, as it is very common to have a Clojure and a Clojure Script connection to the same project, one connection was very limiting. So we wanted to do better and agreed on a solution that was very simple and solved the fundamental problem. We would have a list of connections, but only one of them would be active at any given moment, which would mean that all of the operations would be funneled through it. So you might have five connections for five different projects, but only one of them is the active connection, and there was one simple function that was changing the active connection. So this solved the problem, but it wasn't very convenient, because if you want to work on three projects simultaneously, you always have to keep a mental track of which project are you in, which repo is selected. And we wanted to do more, so we came up with this notion of dynamic dispatch to complement the previous concept, which we labeled retroactively static dispatch. The idea was to associate every repo connection with some project metadata, for instance, the folder from which a connection was started, or something along those lines. So this allowed us to infer more or less which connection maps to which source file. And we believed that this was going to simplify things for everybody. Yeah. Seemed that we added a lot of flexibility. But what happened was that we actually had introduced a lot of complexity, as the new mechanism wasn't very reliable. What happens if you start two connections from the same folder? What happens if you're not using cider jack-in and we cannot actually infer that the project metadata? And also, people who are working on Clojure, on a project that uses Clojure and Clojure Script at the same time, wanted the ability to evaluate code in the two connections simultaneously from CLJC files. So it seemed that, okay, we tried hard, but it wasn't good enough. We came up with a new notion, sessions, basically a group of related connections. So we would be operating on project sessions, active sessions, instead of connections. This seemed to be a step forward, but many of the original problems with the inference were still present. We decided to take things a step further with a more featureful session management solution, which happened to be generic and useful to any tool that needs session management in Emacs. The new project called Sessman, Session Manager, also added more restrictions to the mapping between source files and sessions. It seemed like a really good idea at the time, but if you have been using Cider, probably you hate this, because once we rolled it out, we figured out that it prevented many popular workflows and was a step back for many Cider users. On top of this, this meant that we had introduced a third-party library, so more complexity. We tried and tried and tried to make things better, but it seems that things were actually getting kind of worse, depending on your perspective, and the code base was definitely becoming harder and harder to understand and to maintain. I think that this is a classic example of boy that escalated quickly. And it's also a classic example of, I have this problem that I can solve with regular expressions. 3 days later, now I have two problems. So, you continue to wonder how to deal with all of this complexity. I'm going to write more documentation. Originally, there was pretty much no documentation on connection management in Cider because it was so simple. Now there is an entire chapter of the manual devoted to this. But this hasn't helped much because in the end of the day, well-documented complex code is still complex. So the documentation is not really tackling the complexity issue. What you might have inferred so far from my ramblings is that I'm making the following case. No features, no problems. Or less features, less problems. And this is not very far from reality. But first, I want us to think a little bit about one simple question. Is all complexity the same? Different sources, different people speak about inherent or essential complexity, complexity that is inherent in the business domain that you're working in and that you cannot run away from, and accidental complexity, that's everything else. But I personally like more a different notion of complexity. Core complexity versus peripheral complexity, or if you're more into infrastructure, vertical complexity versus horizontal complexity. What do I mean by those terms? So core complexity for me is complexity that touches many parts of the code base. Core complexity is often accidental complexity. So, you shouldn't be thinking of it as inherent complexity. For instance, the connection management in Cider is core complexity because it touches so much of the code base. It is a core API, but we didn't really need to have the complex connection management that we have today. And the core complexity is the complexity that is always the hardest, the most complex, the most expensive to undo. Then we have peripheral complexity, which is complexity orthogonal to the core functionality. It's basically the stuff that's nice to have, but you didn't really need. And at least in theory, it's easy to undo, and it's typically not coupled with anything important. Here's a fabulous example of peripheral complexity. Notice how many evaluation commands are there in Cider, or repo interaction commands in general. It is extra funny that Cider has so many repo interaction commands that we couldn't fit them in a single menu. We had to have three top level menus just for the Cider commands. A lot of peripheral complexity because a ton of those commands can be removed from Cider. Nobody is going to notice this. Nobody no tools are going to be broken by it. But still, this adds complexity to the code base, as it is more code that somebody has to maintain, understand, whatnot. I like to think of core complexity as the stuff that make the code base harder to comprehend and harder to change. And I really value easier to change as an essential attribute of good code. And for peripheral complexity, I think of as the stuff that makes something harder to learn, like all of those non-essential commands that you have to learn inside there. The core complexity is definitely the scarier of the two, but you have to be wary of both. The peripheral complexity is the type of complexity that you think when you're speaking of death by 1,000 paper cuts, for instance. So going back to Joe's tweet, is there a way out? I think there is a way out, and several projects similar to Cider have demonstrated one of the potential ways out. For instance, Inclosure is a case study of simplicity compared to Cider. No external dependencies, very basic functionality, very few configuration options, works everywhere. It's much easier to work with Inclosure and Enclosure Script, for instance. And the funny thing is that this project I created almost as a joke. I created it in a couple of days. I never really paid much attention, but it seems that a lot of people who are overwhelmed by Cider really enjoy the simplicity and the straightforward nature of Enclosure. So that's pretty cool. And there is also Monroe. A fork of Cider. It basically forked Cider from a very old version before we went overboard with connection management, all sorts of fancy features depending on Cider and repo, and 100 evaluation commands. Basically, Monroe removed everything from Cider that the maintainer of Monroe considered non-essential, and it seems the project is working out very well for many people. Of course, this is also the classic battle between having a lot of convenience and flexibility versus simplicity. Often it is kind of hard to reconcile both. But there is no denying the power of one very old quote by Antoine de Saint-Exupéry, the author of The Little Prince. Perfection is achieved not when there is nothing more to add, but when there is nothing else to take away. It is exactly the same with everything in life, not just with software development. For instance, when I'm working on a presentation, the easy part is to create a boatload of slides, but the hardest part is to leave just enough slides to have a tight and powerful narrative. So I would say that the way out of the complexity trap is to realize that complexity is a choice. And we become victims of complexity because of the choices that we make or don't make. But simplicity is also a choice. We can make the choice to keep our applications, our tools simple. How does this typically happen? Well, every time you are considering adding more functionality and the complexity that goes with it, you should be asking yourself several questions, like how much complexity does something add? What type of complexity is this? Do you have the right skills to maintain it if this is contributed by somebody else? Do you have the desire to maintain it? Whatnot. Obviously, the checklist is going to be different for open source projects, for proprietary projects, but the outline is the same. And if you are in the other side of the spectrum, if you are the person asking for more functionality, you should always ask yourself, when I requested this feature, did I really thought it through? Is this really going to be as great as I claim it's going to be? Probably not. And this is a problem that solves itself, a job for Bender. There is this very famous book, Start With Why. And it is a great book. But I think that when we are talking about complexity, we should also maybe create a book, start with no, or at least start with no. Every time somebody comes to you and says, let's add feature X, start with no, and try to really dig deep into what are the trade-offs that are associated with adding something. I know that this is a hard conversation to have, but this is what I mean by complexity, simplicity, that they are choices. The fact that something seems like a good idea at the time doesn't necessarily make it a good idea. I've seen so many crazy ideas that amounted to a ton of code, a ton of associated complexity, and in the end, they didn't really have a lot of impact. They didn't make the end users happier. They didn't make the engineers more productive. They didn't do anything except add complexity. There is also a lot of chatter in the business circles, in the development circles, that it's great to have bias for action, that you should be moving fast and breaking stuff. And at a certain point in the evolution of projects, of companies, this is a good thing for sure. But I personally feel that bias for inaction is kind of underappreciated, because bias for inaction is the type of thing that brings stability to software system. It is the type of action that makes sure that you are not wasting valuable resources. For instance, you can commit the full force of your company for 6 months to a wild goose chase. If you didn't do anything, nothing lost, right? I have noticed that many Cider users in particular were very happy that I have been practicing bias for inaction recently, or as Rich might probably put it, some hammock time. This means that upgrades are significantly less painful, things are breaking a lot less frequently, and I don't see any urgency to add more stuff, to add more complexity. You know, from time to time, projects are good enough in their current state, and we should just focus on driving them to perfection by removing stuff, removing complexity, and not adding more of it. So, on this positive and somewhat inspirational note, I'll be wrapping it up. Thanks for having me here. It was a great pleasure. Hopefully next time around, I'll see you in person. Take care.
And here we are. Welcome back. Welcome to the Q&A session with Bojida. So once again, thank you for giving yet another talk at the CloJD conference. Not been the first time that since we did that. And of course, thanks for all your work on Emacs and the CloJD ecosystem in that area. I've been using that for many, many years, very happily. So thanks a lot.
Pleasure is all mine. Thanks for having me here. Thanks for giving me the opportunity to think a little bit about complexity and to practice how to do presentations with PowerPoint and to record videos. I learned so much. this is a fun event.
I'm using Pitch right now these days. Somebody said that in the chat in the other town. You never know. We do have some audio notifications going on, but I think they are fairly low levels.
I hear them as well. I have no idea where they're coming from, unfortunately. Is this from Gathertown?
Let's just move on. It's fine. I think they're not too disturbing. So CIDR4.NET is finally confirmed, right? People are wondering.
Absolutely. I have been working on it secretly for 4 years and 2 months, and it is going to rock your world. It is also going to reignite the interest in CloJD CLR. It is going to be game changing, and all of the CloJD developers are moving to Windows natively. No Windows subsystem for Linux required. So stay tuned.
And the release is just around the corner, right?
It's 90% ready.
Talking about the Windows thing, here's one question which goes like this. Do you think using Windows drove you towards working on a different set of problems than you would have chosen otherwise? So kind of does your environment and the operating system that you use drive the features that you develop or the topics that you work on?
No, not really. For me, working on on Windows is exactly the same as working on Linux, because WSL is so seamlessly integrated in the operating system. I run Emacs, for instance, over a Next server that is running in Windows, and you cannot tell the difference. I'm using the same utilities that I was using before, and now Windows has great development tools like a new native Windows terminal and whatnot. So it's Windows only as a shell for me. Actually, Windows is really distracting me for working on development issues because it's so much more fun to be playing StarCraft 2 than to be programming. But that's my weakness.
But on a more serious note, do you happen to know where support for nRapid CIDR on the CLR is today? That's also a question coming from Dominic.
It's not very good. I know that the team behind Arcadia have created a native implementation of nRepo in C#, I believe, but it runs on the CLR, and it supports all of the basic CIDR features. But that being said, I think that the code base is still not isolated from Arcadia. They told me that they wanted to spin it off in a separate project. You know that there is an abandoned port of nRepo for CLR that was more or less an identical implementation of the CloJD of the JVM version. The new version is simpler. It doesn't support middleware. It just provides default implementations of most of the ops. But this is what's needed for the majority of people. The Babashka nRepo has a similar implementation. And I keep telling everybody, nRepo and middleware are orthogonal concepts. You need a server that responds to a certain set of operations in the expected way, and everything is going to work. It doesn't matter how exactly you have implemented the server. So if somebody wants better support for CloJD CLR, I think that they can support the Arcadia nRepo implementation. I haven't used it, but I know that some people are using it, and I hear it, it gets the job done. And it's actually part of the reason why I extended for the very first time the API of nrepo recently. I added code completion and lookup in the server itself because I wanted the simpler servers to support all of the essential functionality for the majority of the users. So you had a couple of more operators and magic, a lot more becomes possible out of the box. So I think it's pretty cool.
Cool, thank you. So maybe moving from, you know, the general state of CIDR and your work on that a bit more to the topic of the talk, here's a nice segue question, which is, have you considered a full rewrite as a version 2 or new plugin as a way to chop off extra complexity?
I don't believe in full rewrites, mostly because I've done so many in my life and I ended up regretting at least 80% of them. A full rewrite is a massive time sink, and it's a massive disruption for the end users. So a full rewrite is definitely not going to be fully compatible with what we have today. CIDR has so many plugins, and this is going to be extremely painful for the users. I ended up maintaining a lot more projects over the years. When I was working just on CIDR, my focus was on a single project all of my time. Now I have the same amount of time, or maybe even less because I have more work and 10 additional projects to maintain. So the likelihood of a full rewrite is small. It is a nice dream, but I don't think that CIDR needs a rewrite. It needs some focused surgical efforts. There are some things that I would probably have done differently, like many things that are in the core would have been some plugins, because I've noticed that people don't use them that much, and they added a lot of complexity for me. I just prefer a smaller, simpler core, the essential functionality. I focus on it, and I would try to solicit the help of more maintainers for the various plugins. But this ship has kind of sailed, and I'll just focus on still improving the core to the extent that it is possible.
Cool. And in a way, CIDR is already a full rewrite of Slime, right? Kind of.
Yeah, it is. It is. And that's why, that's another reason I have it on very good authority that switching between projects, the rewrite, it's very painful. It took us at least 5 years to get to feature parity between Slime and CIDR. So that's a lot of time.
A lot of people on the call today probably joined you on that road. It was nice. Last question from the audience, and then I have one personal more, but let's take the other one first. When you get a well-designed pull request that adds a lot of value, it can be hard to start with no. How do you handle that?
You get used to it. I always appreciate the efforts the contributors put into their PRs, but also encourage people to discuss with me or with other maintainers first the viability of their ideas before committing a lot of their time to something that might not work out. With CIDR, I typically say no to things that I think are unlikely to be used by the majority of the users. Add a lot of typically peripheral complexity, and I'm not personally interested in using this functionality. If the project had more maintainers and they were down, I'd be more receptive to new functionality. But it's really a balancing act, and unfortunately, starting with no is the number one way to keep your sanity. That being said, from time to time, I get persuaded to go in a direction that I don't originally agree with. It's all about making a solid business case. It's in open source. It's exactly like in business. You have to have some impact assessment. You have to have pros and cons. And if the pros significantly outweigh the cons, we'll make it happen, most likely.
Okay, cool. Thanks a lot for all your insights. Last personal question, a simple yes or no will do. Will you be one of the official Emacs maintainers 10 years from now?
I used to be 10 years ago. And it's a very, very hard question, but yes, it's a possibility.
So we have that on video now. Cool. It's been a pleasure talking to you. Thanks. Thanks for sharing your insights and enjoy the rest of the conference. We have a short energizing break now. The next talk already lined up in just about 5 or 10 minutes, something between that. With that, we are out. Thank you all.